वाले सब वीडियो मिलती नहीं है फोन में, पता नहीं कहां से आती है।
दिस रिकॉर्डिंग्स आर ऑन कीपिंग इन द यूट्यूब, आई एम शेयरिंग यू यूट्यूब लिंक्स, यू कैन चेक इन द यूट्यूब, गो एंड ओके, यू जस्ट सब्सक्राइब इन माय चैनल सो यू विल गेट नोटिफिकेशंस, दैट इज द बेटर ऑप्शन। ओके सो नाउ स्टेरिलाइजेशन, वी हैव टू मेथड्स, वी हैव फिजिकल स्टेरिलाइजेशन, देन वी हैव केमिकल स्टेरिलाइजेशन। सो सी, chemical itself is a very large classification, yes. So I'm not going to discuss about chemical in this semester, so I will focus only on physical sterilization. Physical sterilization, we have three methods. One is heat sterilization, then we have irradiation, then we even have filtration. So these are the three methods of physical sterilization.
Hello, now, sir,
let us discuss about heat in detail. Okay, so in the heat sterilization, once again we broadly divided heat sterilization into two types: dry heat sterilization and moist heat sterilization. Okay, see, I need a cloth. Do you have any waste cloth? Okay, it's okay. There is some moisture on the board.
Yes.
And it's not allowing me to write properly. Yes.
Hello.
All right. So coming to the heat sterilization, dry heat sterilization. In the dry heat sterilization, we have microwaving. Okay, microwave, waving, then we have incinerator, okay, incinerator, or something, okay, incinerator, then we have hot air oven, then we have red hot and flame, open flame. So these are the methods of dry heat sterilization. Then we discussed in detail about the hot air oven. So hot air oven is a specialized equipment which is used for killing pathogens or sterilizing the pathogens. In hot air oven, we have three conditions, three temperatures, right? What are the three temperatures? We have four actually. At 160 degrees centigrade, at 170 degrees centigrade, at 180, and at 190. And what are the timings? 160 for 2 hours, and 170 1 hour, 180
30 minutes,
very good, and at 190 5 minutes. So this is all about the hot air oven, dry heat sterilization. Then we move on to the moist heat sterilization. In the moist heat sterilization, we have three methods depending upon the temperature: at 100 degrees centigrade, then below 100 degrees centigrade, and above 100 degree
centigrade.
So these are the three temperatures for moist heat sterilization. So below 100 degree centigrade, we have three methods. Can anyone say? First one is pasteurization. Okay, so that is one technique, and other one is inspissator, by using inspissator, and we have one more which is vaccine bath. Okay, so these are the three methods which are available in the below 100 degree centigrade, right? So what is the temperature for pasteurization? 63 degree centigrade, right? So this is 63 degree centigrade for 2 hours or 1 hour?
30 minutes.
Yeah, so this is the temperature for pasteurization, which is usually used for killing microbes which are present in milk or any liquid media. So that is the temperature, 63 degree centigrade for 30 minutes is the pasteurization. Then inspissator, what is that? Yes, so the temperature for inspissator is 85 degrees centigrade for 3 days. Correct. 3 days? For 1 hour, okay. So at 85 degrees centigrade, 1 hour, we need to sterilize for 3 days, three consecutive days, to kill the pathogen. So that is the purpose of inspissator. Inspissator looks just like a vaccine bath. I think we don't have vaccine bath here. Water bottle vaccine, we don't have. Anyway, so that is inspissator. Okay, after inspissator, we have one other one is vaccine bath. So vaccine bath, or this is commonly it is water bath only. It is a modified water bath. So what is this water bath means? It's just a rectangular. You already saw, right?
Yes,
it's just a bath. It will have water, and that water will be at 37 degrees centigrade. So that is the vaccine bath. So these are the three techniques which are available under 100 degrees centigrade. Then at 100 degrees centigrade, we have three methods. Only one method. Okay, boiling. Then we have tyndallization. Very good. Whatever I said is correct only. Tyndallization is correct. I checked in the textbook. So tyndallization. Then we have one more. Steam sterilization. Steam sterilization. Okay. So these are the three methods we have in at 100 degrees centigrade. And coming to the tyndallization. So tyndallization is a method of killing pathogens, both vegetative and spore forms, at 100 degrees centigrade. That can be achieved by this. So I will discuss about tyndallization here. So what I will do is, what is the temperature for tyndallization? Okay. So at 100 degrees centigrade, I will keep for 1 hour.
1 hour.
80 only, right? Okay. So at 80 degrees centigrade, I will sterilize for 1 hour. After sterilization, I will keep for overnight incubation. So the temperature for incubation will be always room temperature, which is 37 degrees centigrade. So the purpose is, imagine in the media we may have vegetative forms and spore forms. Okay, maybe all vegetative forms can be killed at 80 degrees centigrade, but spores cannot be killed. Yes. Now when we incubate these spores, now I have spores, right? When I'm incubating these spores will become to vegetative forms. They will convert it to normal forms. Still I have few spores, but still some of the spores converted to vegetative. The next day morning, once again I will sterilize at 80 degrees centigrade for 1 hour. Then I can able to kill all vegetatives once again. So I can kill all the vegetatives and few spores may remain in the media. And what I will do, once again I will go for incubation, overnight incubation. Okay. Once again I will keep incubation at 37 degrees centigrade. So even the few spores will also get vegetative, they will convert to vegetative. And on the third day I will do sterilization again at 1 hour. Then I can completely remove all pathogens from this media. So this is called as tyndallization. So I will do three sterilizations for 2 overnight incubations. So this is the method of sterilizing, and this process is called tyndallization. Is this concept clear?
Yes,
Then we have above 100 degrees centigrade. So that can be achieved by using a modified cooker called autoclave. So autoclave is a machine which is used to kill pathogens above 100 degrees centigrade in the presence of, you just write, in presence of pressure. In the presence of pressure. Okay. So what are the temperature requirements for autoclave? So the temperature requirements is, temperature is 121 degrees centigrade, pressure is 15 pascals. Okay. And the time duration is 15 minutes. So these are the temperatures requirements for autoclave. Okay. So this is the complete spectrum of physical sterilization. So this is all about the physical sterilization. Now I will show you the actual images of individual things. Okay. So let us see how the how microwave looks, how incinerator looks. Individually we will see. Okay. By the way, autoclave. So that is the autoclave that we have. So whatever you are seeing, this is an actual autoclave. Okay. So in this autoclave, you can see the parts. I think students in online can see. It has a gauge. It's in the reverse direction. You can see the pressure in it, okay? It's just a meter. So here you can see pressure. This is a safety valve, you know. Excess steam will leak out. And this need to be very tightly. We need to keep the lid. We need to keep very tightly. If not, it will blast. And that's it. The other important thing in autoclave is, see students, after turning on that machine, you need to see, we need to keep the microbes at this at this temperature, at this pressure for 15 minutes. Okay. Now I will turn, now I will keep my pathogens in the autoclave and I will turn on the machine. After 15 minutes, I need to shut down, right? Is that, is so that the process? Yes. So see, I will, this is autoclave. So I kept the pathogen inside the autoclave, maybe the substance. Then I will turn on the machine. So after turning on, slowly the temperature will increase. And slowly, maybe after 20 minutes, after 20 minutes, the pressure will reach to 15 psi. After reaching 15 psi, from this time onwards, we need to keep for 15 minutes. Means after 20, 15 minutes, 35 minutes. Yes, that's it. So after reaching 15 psi, from here we need to count 15 minutes. Keep in mind, not from the time where we switch on the instrument. Is that clear? You understood the concept, right? Yeah. Immediately after switching on, keeping 15 minutes, not the scenario. After getting 15 psi, from 15 psi, it need to stay for 15 minutes. That is the temperature requirement. After the, after 15 minutes, after 35 minutes, can I open the lid? After now I will turn off the instrument and can I open the lid immediately? What will happen? It will blast. There is a 15 psi pressure inside the cooker. So what we need to do is, we need to allow it to cool down and you need to remove the safety pin. So when you remove the safety pin, all pressure will be leaked out. After pressure going, maybe after 1.5 hour, okay? After 1.5 hour, you need to remove the lid. If not, it will, your face will burn if you suddenly remove the lid. So that is all about the autoclave. And also other one is, if you keep autoclave and you forgot to switch off it, okay? Maybe in the night, in the evening at 6 o'clock, you kept the autoclave and you locked the door and you went. Imagine what will happen. Pressure will increase from 15 to 20. Maybe at one point it will go to 50 or beyond 100 psi and room will blast. The autoclave will blast. So that is the major accident that can happen due to autoclave. So always remind to switch off the autoclave after finishing the sterilization. Okay, so this is all about autoclave. Now let us see the actual instruments here. I know students in online, you didn't saw whatever I write on the board. It's okay. Now you will understand the value of offline classes. Okay. Just a second. All right. See, I think there is a booth in my laptop. Without touching, it was showing that laser. Okay. All right. So. So dry heat sterilization. This is incinerator, right? So this is an incinerator where the objects will burn into ashes. So all we will get is ashes only. By the way, we have modern incinerators for humans also. So usually in the cities, we are saying goodbye to the deceased, expired humans by keeping him in an electric incinerator. Can anyone expect the the time? So after keeping the complete human body in the electric incinerator, within how much time the body will become into ashes? 15 to 20 minutes, that's it. Within 20 minutes, you will get the powder. Ashes. Yeah, incinerator will work at very high temperatures, almost at a 700 degree Kelvin. Okay, more than 300 Kelvin. Kelvin means 300 Kelvin will be more than 500 to 600 degree centigrade. So Kelvin is higher unit for centigrade. So at high temperatures, it will use, it will happen. So we will get ashes within a short period of time. So this is incinerator. Then this is a hot air oven. Then we discussed the same things. And this is pasteurization. So usually pasteurization is done for milk. So this is how, in the pasteurization, there are two steps actually. First, we will heat the milk at 83, right? The pasteurization, 63 degrees centigrade. So after 63 degrees centigrade, immediately we will cool down the milk. This is very important in pasteurization. You need to heat the milk and you need to cool down the milk. When you done this, the spores will undergo thermal shock. If they undergo thermal shock, means
suddenly if you are changing a temperature from high temperature to low temperature, the things will break. The molecule, the crosslinks among the molecules will break suddenly because of temperature variation, and that will kill the spores. Okay, so that is the idea of sterilizing by pasteurization technique. Due to heat shock breaking of molecules in, interlinked in between the spores, they will be breaked off and they will die. And this is called pasteurization. Then we have inspissator. So inspissator just looks like a modified water bath, okay, or a waxing bath. So inspissator is used for sterilizing medium such as Lowenstein, Jensen's medium or Loflus medium. These are medias which are used for culturing tuberculosis bacilli. So TB bacilli can be LJ medium. So LJ medium is used for culturing TB bacilli, and that LJ medium need to be sterilized for 3 days at 85 degrees centigrade or 83. Okay. So this is all about the inspissator. Then we have waxing bath or water bath. Both are same. Okay. Water bath will work at 56 degrees centigrade, whereas waxing bath will work at 60 degrees centigrade. That's the only difference. Okay. Both looks the same almost. Same. Okay. So this is waxing bath. Yeah. Then at 100 degrees centigrade, we have boiling, tinderization and steam sterilization. So boiling, I need not to say much. You just torture the bacteria in boiling water and they will die. Then above 100 degrees centigrade. So above 100 degrees centigrade, we will use something called autoclave, and this is the autoclave. The whatever you have on the desk, the same autoclave is this. So it will have the following parts. So typically we have two types of autoclaves: vertical autoclave and horizontal autoclave. So whatever we are seeing here is a vertical autoclave. Other one will be horizontal, okay, like a box. So two types of autoclave we have, just like washing machine, top end and open top and front door. So similarly you have autoclaves also. And the principle is at high temperatures, in the presence of pressure, the spores will be killed. So that's it. That is the basic principle here. Okay. And the components, as I said, it has a pressure gauze, safety valve. So what is the purpose of safety valve is, if the pressure exceeds greater than 20 PSI, greater than 20, if that excessive pressure will be leaked out by safety valve. If we don't have safety valve, means it will blast. The temperature will go beyond 50 to 100 PSI, and it will blast. So in order to limit that problem, we will have a safety valve to the autoclave, and we will have a pressure regulating device. So just like a cooker, you can do it top and it will release the vapor. So these are the three parts. Then it will have a lid, a lid, okay, and open. And it will have handles, basic things. I need not to say much here. So it will have a steam release valve. It will have vacuum release valve. It will have temperature indicator, which is pressure indicator, pressure gauge, and it will have a stand. So these are the basic parts of autoclave. Okay. So the temperatures we already discussed. So if we have 121 degrees centigrade, chamber pressure will be 15 PSI, and holding time is 15 minutes. Then what are the uses of autoclave? So the uses of autoclave are, you can able to sterilize rubber materials. So rubber materials, lab gowns, and even masks can be sterilized in the autoclave. It particularly useful for materials that cannot withstand high temperature. Okay. I cannot keep this mask in a hot air oven. So hot air oven, it may burn. So, but I can keep this in an autoclave. So it will sterilize, right? So that is the main purpose. And also syringes. In the olden days, we used to have borosilicate syringes, glass syringe, glass injection in the olden days. So those glass injections can also be sterilized by using autoclave. But today we don't have that, okay? Today also we are using glass syringes for some special hematological studies. For example, for platelet studies, we will use glass syringe because plastic will have contact inhibition. So these platelets will show affinity. They will show attraction towards the plastic. But if you are using glass, platelets won't attract to the glass. So that's the a property for platelets. Anyway, glass syringes can be sterilized in the autoclave. Then precautions. So there are many precautions. Until escape of the chamber pressure, you should not open the lid. So when it is in 15 psi, if you open the lid, that's it. It will blast. Suddenly it will hit your face. So you need to wait until the pressure goes down to zero. Then only you should open the lid. And also, whatever you kept inside the autoclave, there should be space in between the objects. If it is highly congested, they will crack, right? So these two things you need to keep in mind. Then this is important. Sterilization control. So what is that sterilization control? For example, in the pressure gauze, so this is the autoclave, and here we have a pressure gauze, and this pressure gauze showing 15 psi, okay? Can we, will you trust this gauze? Will you really try? What if the gauze fail? Maybe the pressure meter failed, so simply it is showing wrong reading. Okay? How to identify this problem? How to identify whether gauze is working properly or not?
Temperature.
There is no temperature monitor directly. Since it is working at really high temperatures, the sensor will break off. So there is no temperature monitor here. Only we can rely on pressure gauge. So what we can do? Simply at 15 psi, temperature will be 121. That is how they standardized. What we can do to avoid this problem? What we can do is, along with my flask, maybe I kept a flask in the stabilizer, in the autoclave. Now, I will keep some indicators.
Let him do that.
Okay, so see here. I will keep a tape. I will just keep a tape on this flask, okay? So this is a specialized tape. It has some chemical in this tape. Now, if the temperature reaches to 121 degrees centigrade, this tape color will change to blue color. If this tape color change to blue color, means that indicates, yes, the internal temperature reached 121 degrees centigrade. So after autoclaving, I will remove my flask and I will see the color of my tape. If my tape color change to blue, means yes, I have sterilized at my desired temperature. So this kind of tape can be said as an indicator. Indicator that yes, sterilization completed. If this tape color didn't change to blue, means that indicates the temperature not reached. That indicates internal temperature is not 121. That is why the tape color didn't change. So similarly, we have three types of indicators. We can use three indicators to check whether temperature achieved 121 or not. For that, we can use three indicators. One is chemical indicators. Chemical indicators, okay. The other one is bacterial spores and thermocouple. So other one is bacterial spores and other one is thermal couple. Okay, so what is bacterial spore? Already I know that. I think it is Clostridium species. What the Thermacodes? Okay, Bacillus stereothermophilus. So there is a bacteria called Thermophilus. Okay, Thermophilus. And we already know that the pressure of this, the spore pressure. So these Thermophilus spores will die at 15 psi. Okay, at 15 psi, these spores will die. So what we will do is, I will keep these spores purposefully in the autoclave, known spores, and I will check whether the spores are still there or not. If I didn't see spores, means that indicates I achieved sterilization temperature. If I'm still seeing spores, means that indicates it haven't sterilized properly. So I can use either chemical indicators or I can use known bacterial spores. This is good bacteria, it won't cause any problem for us. I can use known bacterial spores, or I can also use some thermocouples. Thermocouple means it is like a sensor only, okay, a potentiometer. It is an electrical sensor. So these are the three indicators we can use to check, to use as a controls. Controls to check whether the desired temperature achieved inside the autoclave or not. So this is all about the sterilization controls, okay, or indicators. So this is the tape that I'm telling. So this tape looks white here or brown in color, but when we sterilized, when we expose this tape to 121 degree centigrade, it will turn to blue color. So if it turned to blue color means that's it, we achieve the sterilization. So this is all about the autoclave and its operation. So now what we can do is, the next topic is, okay, let me open the syllabus. So in the unit 4, so all these are in unit 4, keep in mind. So in the unit 4, we discussed about sterilization, disinfection, effective and hand hygiene. Hand hygiene we discussed in the previous unit, the PPE, right? In the personal protective equipment. Then we have a topic called prevention and control of common health associated infections and components for an effective infection control program in the hospital. So how to manage these cross infections, how to prevent these infections in the hospital? Very simple. I will discuss about precautionary measures in the hospital. Just a second. Okay, infection control measures. So write down the next second topic, which is infection control measures. So the next topic is infection control measures. Infection control measures. So next topic is infection control measures. Why Deepak late?
Sir,
close the door. Your name? Arman Khan. Okay, sit in your place. Okay, so the next topic is infection control measures. I hope students in online, you can see the screen, whatever I'm sharing, right?
Yes, sir, your screen is visible.
Yes, okay. So the next topic is a very short topic, infection control measures. So we already know. So what is the definition of infection control? So these are certain practices. Students, quiet. So these are certain practices and procedures to prevent infection, cross infection in the hospital. Okay, it can be done either by disinfection, aseptic conditions, sterilization, or we have one more, antiseptics, by using antiseptics. So let us see what are the precautionary measures we can take. We can take this lecture for a 10 days class. We can also finish this topic in 1 day class. So I'm taking the shortcut approach because in the future, in the next semester, you have a dedicated subject called infection control. So in that you can study for six months. So there you will enjoy this infection control. So let me be brief in today's session. Okay. So we have different types of precautions. So standard precautions and additional precautions. And these precautions was given to us by, there is a organization which was internationally standardized for infection control, and that organization is CDC. Okay, so CDC stands for Control for Disease, Center for Disease Control. Okay, please, I said 1,000 times. Center for Disease Control. So Center for Disease Control will give guidelines on preventing cross infections in the hospitals, and CDC works under the World Health Organization. Okay, so from here the nations will adopt the guidelines and they will keep their standardized SOPs according to the nation. See, you are damn late to my lecture and you are happily coming to my classes. You won't get attendance. Okay, Abhishek, Vishal, Deepak 63 and Arman. Hare Krishna. Okay. Okay, listen to me. You are wasting my time. CDC will give the guidelines, okay? So CDC, in our nation, in India, the organization that will take care of healthcare activities is ICMR. So ICMR guidelines will be adopted to the whole India, okay? ICMR itself is a branch of MOH. So ICMR will work under the funding of MOH, Ministry of Health Affairs, okay?
So under MOHGHA, ICMR will give localized guidelines to prevent cross infections within the hospital. So that guidelines also includes the biomedical waste management. It includes cross infection management, nosocomial management, patient management, even patient safety is given by the MOH. The syllabus that we took for your new semester for 2021 batch, okay, this is first time in India directly we adopted syllabus from MOH. So no one can say any excuses for your syllabus. Your curriculum is completely 100%. Whatever they recommended for MLT, the complete syllabus was adopted to you in your semester. So you can go for even other countries also, and no one can refuse your certificate after finishing BSc MLT. Galgoti is the first university in India to completely implement 100% MOH syllabus. It comes with some challenges. You have 15 subjects in the first semester, right? Yes, previously it is only 7 or 8. So we are taking this because from now onwards we are changing the protocols. We don't need technologists, we need scientists. So we are working in that direction. So please study accordingly. Don't play in the campus, okay? Take these things seriously. Obviously you should have fun. With the fun, you must have academic skills also, academic excellence also. Keep that everything, okay, in the mind. So we have certain standard precautionary measures. I'm not going to discuss these other things, same. CDC given certain definitions. So the basic infections. So now there are some common infections that will transmit in the hospital, okay? So common hospital infections include 5. So these 5 are bloodborne infections. Bloodborne infections. So these 5 bloodborne infections include, write down, this is standardized everywhere. Malaria, then we have syphilis, then you have hepatitis. Hepatitis, we have 2 types, hepatitis B and hepatitis C. Then we have one more, which is HIV. So these are the most common bloodborne infections that we will encounter in the hospital. Okay, most common bloodborne nosocomial infections. Syphilis, okay. So malaria, syphilis, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and HIV are the most common nosocomial infections. Bloodborne. Syphilis, SYPHINLIS, syphilis, okay. So syphilis, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and HIV. Other than this, other hospital-borne infections include staph and staphylococcal infections, streptococcal infections, and pneumococcal infections. Pneumococcal infections are common infections in hospital. Okay? Pneumococcal, staph infection. In staph species, we have some 80 bacteria in staph alone. And in strepto alone, we have 122 strains or 122 individual bacteria. So it's a very big domain. So simply I can staph, staphylococcal, and pneumococcal. So these are the most common hospital infections we will encounter. Okay? Most common nosocomial infection. Nosocomial infection or hospital acquired infection or cross infection are same. Keep this in mind. Okay? So the standard precautions are given to eliminate these kind of things. So these can transmit through blood, body fluids, okay, body fluids or by direct or indirect contact, okay. Body fluids include urine, sputum, semen, everything. That's it. So this is all about the precautions. Then as I said, few body fluids include blood, vomit, saliva, stool, urine, nasal drainage, okay, nasal secretions, scrapings of the wound, secretions from mucous membranes such as sputum, and vaginal and semen. So these are the few secretions of few body fluids from where there is a possibility of getting cross infection. And the standard precautions include, we have 4 important steps. First, we always must use personal protective equipment. After using personal protective equipment, we should impose decontamination programs in the hospital. Okay, decontamination programs such as sterilization techniques. All these are decontamination steps. It can be dry, moisture, chemical, irradiation, anything. After decontamination protocols, we should have an effective hand washing techniques.
thanks to the Joseph Lister. So the hand, the significance of hand washing dates back to Joseph Lister, father of antiseptic surgery. He's the one who developed that boric acid as a good sterilizer. So you need proper hand washing protocols in the hospital, and also you need a proper biomedical waste management. So these four are the four pillars for prevention of any infection in the hospital. So what are the four? Usage of personal protective equipment, decontamination or sterilization techniques, then hand washing protocols, and waste disposal, biomedical waste management. So these four are four major pillars for prevention of any infections in the hospital. So the same thing, I will discuss the story. So PPE, you know that PPE will limit getting infection to the hospital personals. So it can be gloves, apron, gowns, protective eyewear, face shields and masks. Then you know how to wear the gloves, how to remove the donning of PPE, doffing of PPE, key points, you know. So that, then you have decontamination. So decontamination includes sterilization techniques. It can be autoclaving, it can be hot air ovens, incinerating, pasteurization. So all those are decontamination procedures. Then you have effective hand washing procedures. There is a way of washing your hands. There are certain steps to wash the hands. So first you need to apply, first you need to wet the hand, then apply the soap, then start interlocking your fingers, start washing in the fingers, then interlock like there is a way. Okay, so on the palm also you need to wash on the both the palms. After finishing your hand washing, never touch the tap again. Okay, after finishing hand washing, don't touch the tap again, rather than close the tap with your elbow. Okay, so that is the important steps, and the overall time should be within 10 to 15 seconds is not correct. It should be minimum 5 minutes. It should 3 to 5 minutes you need to wash the hand. I think there is a problem with this slide. Okay, so you should wash for at least 3 to 5 minutes. Okay, that is the standardized timing. Okay. Then waste disposal. So waste disposal, biomedical waste management. You have all the things that we discussed previously, right? So that's it. Don't worry, this is the same thing that we discussed, that categories, color coding, treatment, all this is all about biomedical waste management. So additional precautions include the environment should be clean in the hospital, the handling of patient care equipment, whatever equipment we are using to handle patient, that should be hygiene. Injections should be given safely to the patient, and also there should be respiratory hygiene. So that is all about precautions for prevention of cross infection in the, or infection control measures in the hospital. So these four are important. Kindly remember these four. So maybe write it down. Standard precaution measures. Write the side heading. Standard precaution measures to. Standard precaution measures to prevent infection. Standard precaution measures to prevent infection. Standard precaution measures to prevent infection. So write down. So there are four steps. There are four steps. 1, 2, 3, 4. Just write these four steps. So that is all about infection control measures. So from tomorrow onwards, I will start discussing antibiotic resistance in the pathogens. Okay, yes. A really interesting topic. So by this, we can say goodbye to this topic. See, I'm not exactly following the pattern that is given in the syllabus. Rather than I'm going in my style, okay? So that I'm covering everything. So don't feel like I'm skipping any parts in the syllabus. I'm covering everything in my own way, okay? So whatever you are getting is in correct way. So can I end this class? Let me download the attendance. So online students, is everything clear for you? Any more doubts for you in this topic?
No, sir, no doubt.
In sterilization and prevention?
No, sir.
Okay. All right. So thank you very much, students.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Let me take an attendance for you.
Okay, see here. Ensure that all your faces will be there. You know, this is attendance. I need to 1, 2. All right. So I need to remember just Shivam, right? Shivam. Then you are Hare Krishna, not Abhishek. Okay.
सर कल दो तीन दिन हो गए सर, टोटल अटेंडेंस नहीं लिखा है सर, ऑल क्लासेस का सर अटेंडेंस
लिखा है सर. ओके द अटेंडेंस हैज बीन वन मिनट, द टाइम टेबल हैज बीन अपडेटेड
सर.